The name is mine. The name of daddy's blood on it. Now, she want to go. She can go.
I know you're sick and tired of waiting on me, girl, but I just trying to get my money right. Soon as I'm done, we can take a flight so I can take you all around the world. Planes, trains, automobiles, Bentley overrange, chromed out wheels, first class ticket G4, you let me deal for real.
She like black Bentley coupes, black Daytona.
What's going on, everybody? Welcome to another episode of the Mack Lessons Radio Show. And I'm your host, Mr. Tariq King Flex Nasheed, broadcasting live here in Los Angeles, California. Glad to have everybody tuning back into the show. Today's show is brought to you by MackLessons.com. That's where you can get the Mack Lessons DVD. And today's show is brought to you by OfficialUPA.com, UnitedPlayersOfAmerica.com. That's where you can chop it up with other players such as yourself. Also, don't forget, March 1st, which is in a few days from now, you can get the Mack Lessons in Brazil show. You're going to get to see home video of my trip down to Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. There's a lot of nice beach footage, a lot of real good footage you guys need to check out. You can register for that show at MackLessons.com. Real good stuff. On today's show, we're going to talk about Mackin rules at the club. I'm going to give you 5 good Mackin tips for the club. That's going to help you step up your game. Let me talk about some of the stuff that's been going on in the media. Real quickly, I want to give a shout out to Jennifer Hudson. She won the Oscar for Dreamgirls. Very proud of her. I think they robbed Eddie Murphy, though. I think Eddie Murphy was definitely robbed of that goddamn Oscar. The guy who was in that movie, Little Miss Sunshine, he won the Oscar, which was a good movie. That Little Miss Sunshine movie was very good. That guy was very entertaining in the movie, but Eddie Murphy should have gotten that. But I digress. But Jennifer Hudson, she's on her way. I'm telling you, that's going to be the new Oprah. That's going to be the new Nell Carter. America has found their new sassy fat black chick. But I like Jay Hood. I like her. She's an underdog. She's doing her thing. I found out that they wanted Fantasia to be in that role in Dreamgirls. I didn't know that. Somebody just recently told me that. I think Jamie Foxx recommended Fantasia, but they went with Jennifer Hudson. You know, I kind of hate to admit, I'm almost ashamed to admit, I'm very ashamed to admit, that Fantasia, she's one of those weird-looking chicks. I would probably bang her. There's something about her that makes me want to hit that. I don't know what it is. I'm kind of ashamed to admit that, but there's something about Fantasia that just makes me want to hit that one good time. Now, I know she looks like a goddamn duck with no beak, but there's something about her. I don't know what it is. Just the novelty. I don't know. But I digress. But anyway, like I said, on today's show, we're going to talk about some Mack rules for the club. I went out last night with the partners. We had a real good time last night. In the club game, you know, it kind of changes up every 5 years. You know, you got to kind of shift your game to another level. The game pretty much stays the same, but, you know, you get different techniques that you have to use. You have to change your game up a little bit because the whole vibe of the club scene changes up every few years. It gets a little more Mackish. The vibe gets a little more simpish. So you have to go to one extreme or the other every now and then. But the game is real basic. The game pretty much stays the same, but sometimes you have to use different techniques. Just like in basketball, the basic rules are there, but every now and then you get somebody who brings the sky hook to the game. You get somebody who brings the backhanded dunk. You dig? You get some cats who bring in a new technique to the game. So I went out last night. We had a good time, and I'm noticing a lot of changes in the game. So brothers got to step their game up extra Mackishly. But I'm going to give you five general rules of the Mackin game when you're going out to the clubs. So I want everybody to go get their pens and their paper and jot some of this good shit down. Now, rule number one, players, when you go to the club, you need to plant seeds early. Now, what I mean by that, when you hit the club up, you're going to see a lot of women there. It's early. You need to go in there and plant seeds in the women's minds. Like, hey, what's up? My name is such and such. Put your bid in early with a number of women and just kind of kick back and fall back for a minute. You have to go to the club and get a rapport going on with all the females before the thirsty nigga starts brown-nosing them, buying them drinks, kissing ass, all that. You have to let your presence be known very early. You plant the seed of game. Holler at them. Don't holler at them too hard. The objective is numbers. You're trying to holler at as many of them as possible to plant the seed, to let them know that you're in the house. Then as the night progresses, you've gained a rapport with the women. You can go and water your seeds throughout the night, periodically. Like when you walk into a spot, you see 20 fine females scattered around. You step to all of them like, hey, how you doing? What's your name? You having a good time? Okay, let me go holler at my friends. I'll be back in a minute. You do that with about 20 women. That's planting the seed. So throughout the night, you can check up on them. You've got somewhat of a rapport with them. But you're not sweating them. You're stepping to them on a courtesy level. Got that? So that's going to make your game a little more easier when you want to get deep with them. When you want to really close the deal, you've got that rapport. You're not mad dogging and hounding the female. You following me, fellas? Now, this brings me to rule number two. Now, after you've gained a rapport with a female, you have to show genuine interest by using her name. And I think I said this in the book, The Art of Mackin, that you got to drop the woman's name every now and then to let her know that you're just not Mackin to random chicks, which you are, but you're going to be a thorough nigga with it. So you have to utilize the woman's name. That makes the conversation more personal. Got it? Now, with that being said, you have a lot of women out here with these crazy goddamn names. That's damn near impossible to remember. I met a few women last night. They told me their names about 3 or 4 times. I kept getting them wrong. And on a side note, why is it that the most ghetto-ass women or women with the most ghetto-ass name get offended when nobody can pronounce that shit? Some of you women know your name is really ghetto and fucked up. Don't get mad at people when they can't pronounce that shit. Like, if you call a female house, you'd be like, may I speak to Shaquinta? And they'd be like, it's Shaquinte. Like, get the fuck out of here. But I digress. But again, fellas, when you meet a lot of women, man, they have these very unique names, these wild names. What you do in that situation, because it's impossible to believe all this, to remember all these long syllable-ass names. What you do, give her a nickname. Just let her know, hey, look, your name is kind of difficult. Your name is kind of hard for me to remember. So I'm going to give you a nickname. So if the name starts with the letter A, just say, hey, I'm going to call you A-Dog. If it starts with the letter O, I'm going to call you O. Or give her a nickname based on what she looks like. If she's a light-skinned chick, I'm going to call you Yellow Girl. If you're dark, I'm going to call you Mocha. Just be bold with that. It's not a rude thing. Just like, look, I don't want to keep mispronouncing your name, so I'm going to give you a name. Your name is going to be Scooby because you look like a dog. Whatever. So give him a nickname. And that brings us to rule number three. Rule number three, you have to give tactful compliments. You feel me on this, fellas? Guys ask me all the time, is it nice to compliment women? It's cool to compliment them in a tactful way. Now, what I mean by this is when you compliment a woman, never compliment her on her beauty. Never say, wow, you are so pretty. Wow, you're the most beautiful woman in the club. Wow, you got a gang of ass. You don't do that. That puts you in a brown-nosing position. It makes you look like a kiss-ass. If you compliment a woman, give her a compliment on, like, her mental status. Just say, hey, look, you seem like you have a good head on your shoulders. You dig? Or compliment her clothes, like, hey, I like those boots you got on. Because the thing about it, as a player, the compliment has to be genuine. When you compliment a woman, you're not going to bullshit her. You're not going to, because women know themselves better than anybody. So if you say to a woman who's a dumbass that, oh, you seem like you got a good head on your shoulders, she knows you're full of shit because she knows she don't have a good head on her shoulders. So don't tell her that. The compliment has to be genuine. You dig? Don't give a woman, if a woman has like a fucked up weave in her hair, don't be like, oh, your hair is beautiful. She know her shit is fucked up. She knows she didn't have money to go to the hairdresser. She knows she did her shit in the kitchen. So don't go there. Keep it real with her. Give her a real tactful compliment. Women can smell bullshit a mile away. So if she is the kind of woman who prides herself on having a good head on her shoulders or prides herself on being educated, compliment that. Like, you seem like you are very scholarly. You seem like you're very academically inclined. Like, well, thank you. I like that dress you have on. It's very nice, very classy. I like it. Make your compliments very tactful. Got it? Now, rule number four. Do not back down from a power struggle. I'm going to repeat that one again. Do not back down from a power struggle. Now, a lot of women will do this in the club. They'll have some sort of power struggle with you at the club. Let me give you an example. Like, you across the room, and this kind of happened to me last night. A girl is sitting across the room. You're across the room. You're like, hey, come over here. Let me holler at you. And a lot of women will do some shit like, well, you come over here. Check that shit. Like, look, no. Bring your ass over here. Or if you go over there, you have to let her know that you're not about the power struggle. Because, fellas, you know what I'm talking about. A woman's on one side of the room, you're standing over here, y'all going back and forth. Come over here. You come over here. Come over here. You come over here. Well, meet me halfway. You meet me halfway. You go, look, step to her and you say this. Look, why are we going through this power struggle? Why are you trying to have a power struggle with me and I just met you? And she might say some shit like, well, I like dudes to come to me. If you like me, you come to me. Like, look, look, stop all that. Look, we're on the same page. You're cool. I'm cool. We're trying to get to know each other. I'm not trying to have a power struggle with you. I'm just trying to chop it up with you. So just let your defenses down and let's chop it up. Now, if you say some shit like that, that'll put her mind at ease. And you let her know that you're not really no simp-ass nigga that's going to be bowing down. You always have to check that power struggle immediately, right then and there. Some women might say something like I know this happens to me a lot when I say, look, here, let me give you my number. Just give me a buzz probably tomorrow. Then a woman will say, well, how come you can't get my number and call me? I check them because I told you to call me. That's why I'm not power struggling with your ass. Let them know. Let them know you're not having a power struggle. Chill and relax. You're on the same page with me. I'm telling you, fellas, this goes a long way because if you bow down to those power struggles, it's a wrap. You've established yourself as a wuss. The first impression is a lasting one. You have to establish a domineering presence. If you bow down to whatever she says, like, how come you don't call me? Okay, I'll call you. What's your number? If a woman says, well, you come over here. Okay. here I am. You're the most beautiful woman in the world. You know how that shit looks to them? Do not bow down to those power struggles. But you do everything in a tongue-in-cheek kind of way. When you check them. You check them in a smirky kind of way. But you let them know that you're real about it. But do not bow down. And that also brings us to rule number 5. Rule number 5 is that you always check cock-blocking females. Now, cock-blocking right now is at an all-time high. Like, I was out last night. We went to a whole bunch of different spots. Every blue moon, me and my partners will just club hop. And, like, last night, I met a whole bunch of women last night. And it was like three of them, of the women that I met last night, they had fat cock-blocking homegirls with them. The cock-blocker is always fat for some reason. But in every instance, I'm talking to the girl, the female I'm spitting at, and then the cock-blocking friend is off in the side like, come on, we gotta go. I'm outside the club talking to another female, cock-blocking friend. We gotta go. Come on, girl. You don't let that slide. Because the girls that I was talking to, I had them wrapped up with game. They weren't going nowhere. The homegirls kept calling them, and I kept spitting. And the girls that I was macking to, they didn't budge because the game I was spitting was nitro. It was hypnotic. So the girls would come over there to physically come get her. That's when I would check them. I'd be like, tell your homegirl to come here. Come here. And I'm saying this to the fat broad. I'm like, look, what's your name? And I do it very tongue-in-cheek, very lightheartedly, but I do it in a stern way. I'm like, look, what's your name? They tell me their name. I'm like, look, why are you throwing salt in my game? I'm saying this in front of the girl I'm spitting at. I'm like, why are you throwing salt in my game? And they'll say some shit like, well, you know, it's late and, you know, we got to go to work and I need her to come on. I'm like, look, wait a minute. She's here to have a good time. This is a social setting. I'm spitting game. You about to throw salt in her game. She's meeting a fly nigga. Let her be happy. And we all kind of laugh it off, but I make that dominance known. I let her know that it wasn't cool to be cock-blocking the game. And that lets the female that you're dealing with know that you ain't no sucker, soft-ass nigga. That lets them know that you're on top of your shit. That's very impressive to let them know that you won't tolerate anything, any kind of disrespect. Because to me, when females be cock-blocking, even though it's not a personal thing, it's still disrespectful to me. Yeah, I like 110% respect. So if your homegirl is trying to throw salt in the game, I'm a checker. And fellas, you should do the same too. Because again, like I said, cock blocking is at an all-time high, man. These fat broads are throwing salt in the game. When they got like a dime friend or a real cute friend with them, these broads be throwing salt. They be mad as hell that nobody's talking to them. And I'm not going for the okey-doke. So those are the 5 basic club rules that I'm giving today. I'm going to give some more later on this month. Now, let me read an email from one of the listeners. Got this from a brother from MySpace. His name is Jay. And his email says, what's up, Tariq? I'm going to sum it up for you very quickly because I know you're a busy man. Here it is. I've been with my wife for almost 16 years. We have 3 kids together. But we've only been married for only 3 years. That's just nigga shit. My niggas be killing me with that shit. Niggas be living together for 20 years and be married for 1 year out of those 20 years. That's nigga shit. My thing is, if I'm going to be in a relationship with somebody for more than 2 years, I marry them. Fuck it. That's why I don't do long-term relationships. I think the longest relationship I've been in is like a year. if I don't see it growing, if it's not growing, let's just charge it to the game and be friends. I'm not in the bullshit business. 16 goddamn years. Then y'all decide to get married 3 years ago. Time in life is too valuable for that, man. That's a lifetime, man. But I digress. Anyway, they've been married for 3 years. He's 32 years old, and she is 37. My problem is that I can never seem to make her happy. She is withholding sex from me because she's hung up on some shit that happened in the past that she was mostly responsible for but won't take responsibility for her actions with. Which he didn't state what that was. So I'm going to have him email me what that was because that's kind of interesting. But I digress. The letter goes on to say that I have been trying to talk to her and it's like talking to a fucking wall, man. Nothing seems to work. She never initiates sex. It's like I'm begging her for it all the time. She got some real issues that I'm beginning to think has nothing to do with me. She came from a single parent raised home. She was raised by her mother and her grandmother. It seems like every woman in the family has some men issues. I mean, sisters, cousins, aunts, etc. And no man was present for any of them. I'm telling in a roundabout way that if she does not take care of her man, then somebody else will. He's telling her in a roundabout way. I'm kind of paraphrasing these emails because you know how these guys be writing these emails with these run-on sentences. She still wants to move. And when she does, it's... Wait. I don't know what this nigga's saying. Okay, basically he's saying when they have sex, she just has sex to shut him up. He goes on to say, I'm so sick of this shit. I'm on top of my game. I prayed for an answer and somehow I ended up on your MySpace page. I went out and bought your book because I felt like it was time for me to upgrade. Last thing, one day we were just casually talking and she asked me if we were to divorce, would I get married again? He told her, no. One wife was enough. Then she turns around and says that she would get married again. But this time, she would get married to an older man with some money. Ain't that a bitch? The letter goes on to say that she probably already has him on standby. What should I do? Seriously, I need some help. Well, basically, man... Jay, you got married, not married, but you've been in a long-ass relationship with this woman. This seems like the only woman you've ever dated. 16 years. Y'all been with each other since you were teenagers. You never went through the player stage. She never went through her hoochie stage, basically. And she's resentful. And people take out their resentment on the people that's closest to them. I always say familiarity breeds contempt, man. That's why people have to get hobbies. You seem like, man, Jay, you've been hemmed up with this woman just looking in her face for 16 years. Just holding on to each other, codependent on each other. After a while, man, somebody's going to get frustrated. And she's the frustrated one. There's no challenge. There's nothing. And you begging for sex, that's a trick hoe marriage. The average man gets into these trick hoe marriages. And after a while, man, women get tired of being the leader in the relationship. Because if it's a trick hoe marriage, the woman is the leader. The woman can control you. Women don't like to control dudes. It's a catch-22, though. Because like you said, Jay, this woman came from a single parent home where the women were running things. This puts an unnatural mind state in the woman's mentality. They think that it's the normal thing to do, which is run the family. That's not normal. That's not natural. So when these women subconsciously get into these relationships that they're dominating, they're not happy. women like this, Jay, and all my players out there who grew up in these single mother homes, used to seeing domineering women and all the women have man problems, they would never, ever, ever be happy. They just won't. Because life is a catch-22. They look for men that they can dominate, and when they dominate them, they don't respect them. Happiness is never there. You ever seen these families of women, nothing but miserable women in the family? Nobody knows how to break that chain. You don't get caught up in that. That has nothing to do with you whatsoever, Jay. You're just a nigga who's just happy somebody's fucking you, which you shouldn't be. You should step your game up, nigga. You're 32 years old. There's still time. You really got to step your game up. You're just happy to be getting some ass. So really step your game up, man, because it sounds like this shit is going downhill, like it's been going downhill fast. And get some shit going on in your life, man, where you ain't got to sit up and be begging your wife for pussy. When niggas at that point begging the wife for pussy, you ain't got nothing else going on. If it gets that, I'll be honest, man. I try to be straight up and down. I'd get a mistress. I get a mistress like a motherfucker. And let my wife know. And if she wants a divorce, whatever. Nothing from nothing equals nothing. You probably don't have no money. Because if she's threatening to leave to get a dude with some money. Now she's saying some blatantly disrespectful shit to you. Now, if they're disrespecting you like that, man, it's really going downhill. When women start to blatantly disrespect you, it's time to charge that to the game, to be honest, man. She's blatantly disrespecting you. And if she can't be happy, it ain't got nothing to do with you. She's going to drag you into her pit of unhappiness. So think about that, man. Step your game up, man. You got to change who you are. You got to not change who you are, but build on who you are, man. You got to become a new person, so to speak, man. You got to get out of that wuss shell that you've been in for 16 years. You need to flip the script tonight, nigga. Tomorrow morning, you need to wake up as a whole different person. Nigga, right now, you're Professor Clump. Tomorrow, you need to wake up as Buddy Love. And be Buddy Love. You need to become a whole new nigga. You need to become real Mackish overnight, man. That's the only thing that's going to save your situation, is that you become a totally different person overnight. And put a jolt back into the game. Familiarity breeds contempt, player. Anyway, that's been today's episode of the Mack Lessons Radio Show. I'm glad that everybody tuned in. Don't forget, register for the Mack Lessons in Brazil show, the pay-per-view video special. You're going to see home videos of my trip down to Brazil. Register at MackLessons.com. I will holler at you players and playettes tomorrow. Peace.